Tom Hudgens, and I'm playing Peter.
Mercedes McNabb, Patricia.
Tim Hulse, and I'm playing Michael.
Floriana Alessandria, I'm playing Lane.
Woo!
Sarah Kernish, I'm playing Rachel.
Stacey Anderson, I'm playing Glenn / Glinda.
Steve Price, I'm reading Tom. Skylar Collins, reading the stage directions. The Sand Game, by Karen Schiff. Act 1, Scene 1. A late afternoon in July. A restaurant in New York City. As the lights come up, Lane, Rachel, Michael, and Patricia sit at a table. They are all dressed in black. Rachel is 7 months pregnant with twins. Their server, Glenn, pours coffee.
They bury each other.
Rachel.
In the sand?
Yes.
Yes, in the sand. They bury each other in the sand.
Oh. Well, all the way? How do they breathe?
No. Just up to their necks. You should see them. They have this whole pre-game ritual. Michael got these two plastic mini shovels from Grandma Rose when he was little. So first thing, he offers the shovels to Lane. She chooses her weapon. Then they cover each other with sand very, very slowly, working their way up from their toes. Everything gets buried except their heads and, you know, their hands. And then they just lie there.
Can we get the check, please?
Well, what's the point? I mean, how do you win?
It's like an endurance thing. Whoever gets up from the sand first loses. I can't believe you haven't told her about it. Lane loses every year.
Rach.
Every year? How long has it been?
Since
we invaded Panama.
No, that was the year before.
No, it wasn't.
Yes, it was, Michael. Do the math.
Since 1991, it's really quite shocking considering how our Lane hates to lose.
Why are you
She can't hold it in.
No, why are you still
World's smallest bladder.
Do you mind?
After about an hour, she gets up out of the sand and yells, I gotta go!
You mean like to the bathroom?
Exactly. She makes a beeline to the deck and runs back to the house each year, making Michael Gerson, once again, king of the sand game.
Do you play too?
They wouldn't let me.
You were fine.
So they made me ref. I watch from the back deck of the house, and I'm not allowed to go down to the beach.
Why not?
It's a rule.
Oh.
Glenn enters.
What do you do, honey, when you're laying there? I mean, it sounds sort of... Do you get bored?
No, you should see him. Lane takes his hand, he whispers something to him, he starts battling away. He doesn't stop the whole game.
Whenever you're ready.
I'll get it.
No, don't.
Lane.
Don't.
Let her take.
What do you talk about?
When?
During the game, what do you talk about?
Nothing, just work stuff.
He's doing you a favor, believe me. I mean, who wants to sit around and listen to stories about intelligent signal processing? Why do they include the modifier intelligent? Isn't that obvious?
Lane.
What? I mean, there's no such thing as stupid signal processing, is there?
I don't think so.
She's kidding.
So then why not just say signal processing?
Not all signal processing is intelligent. There's another model.
Really? What?
Statistical. It's applied to less complex systems.
Which model do you prefer?
God, you were so pissed. Remember the night of the first game, Mom and Dad went out and left Lane in charge? She was chasing Michael all over the house, screaming at him, come on, tell me! I don't know what it was. I didn't know what they were talking about, but it looked like fun, so I started yelling at him too.
Poor baby Micah.
Well, what did you want to know?
She had to know why he liked Olivia, and he wouldn't tell.
Well, who's Olivia?
His first girlfriend.
Oh, you never told me.
Patty Cake. I was 13. I think I'm over her.
Anyway, the next morning, Lane drags us out of bed at 5:30 to play this crazy game.
Why so early?
It starts at sunrise, every first Sunday of every July.
Oh. But that's today.
Well, right. We need to skip it this year.
Yeah, I try to bury only one relative a day.
Honey, it's getting late. I should get to the airport.
Where are you going?
Back to California.
But you just got in last night.
I'm so sorry. I have a sales call first thing in the morning with an orthopedist at Stanford. She's really hard to make an appointment with. I couldn't reschedule.
Oh my God, I can't believe you flew all the way out here just for the funeral. That was so sweet.
You're not going back already too, are you?
No, of course not. I'm just going to help her get a cab.
I'm so sorry about your father. I know how much he meant to all of you. Have a good trip back to Minnesota, Rachel. And good luck with the twins. I wish we could come out and help you.
Oh, that's okay. I understand. Anyway, Lane's going to come out.
Oh, don't get up. Take care. It was nice to see you, Lane.
Patricia gives Lane a kiss.
You too. Thanks for coming all the way out. It really was very sweet.
Yes, it was. Very, very sweet.
Michael tenderly kisses Patricia on the lips. They exit.
Well, praise the Lord, looks good.
Stop calling her that. Her name is Patricia.
No, it's not Patricia. It's Patricia Torrey Lewis, PTL. Don't you think it's a little weird that every woman Michael dates is a religious monogram?
But we're not religious. I mean, we're
politics.
No, seriously.
Cultural Jews.
That's it.
And that's what makes it so ironic.
What's so ironic?
Michael's girlfriends, their initials, they're all religious acronyms.
Oh, Lane, please, stop. Who else?
Jesse Hannah Carlisle.
What?
Jesus H. Christ.
Diana Diego Martinez.
Ay, Dios mío.
Olivia Markowitz. Why do you hate them so much?
I don't hate them. I just object to the idea of spending major holidays with them in perpetuity. I mean, what would we talk about? They're all very nice and pretty, but they're not exactly the brightest tinsel on the tree, you know what I mean?
They're not stupid. Look at Patricia. She's very successful. She raked it in last year.
She's a drug dealer.
She sells pharmaceuticals.
And she has absolutely no sense of humor. Like at Dad's funeral today, she wanted to know why the casket was closed. I said, so he can't see that Uncle Mort didn't show up. It would kill him. Nothing. Nothing. She just stared at me like I was some freak.
No,
no, Rach. Don't tell me you don't know what I'm talking about. I've seen her give you the same look.
It's not relevant. We're not marrying them.
Yeah, well, neither is Michael.
No, he's really going to ask her. Don't you think?
Wouldn't he have already?
How would I know? You're the one who talks to him during the sand game. You tell me.
I don't know. I just can't believe it.
Can't believe what?
That she's his soulmate.
Maybe he doesn't want a
soulmate. I mean, for God's sake, he calls her patty cake. How does she stand it?
I don't know. Maybe she likes it. Maybe she gets it.
Gets what?
That he likes it.
Oh, come on. Would you put up with that?
No, but I don't have to. I didn't marry someone like Michael. I never wanted to.
Hel is my favorite Norse god.
Eric, he's fine. He's really sorry he couldn't make it. You know how crazy he was about Dad.
Mm. How's his leg?
It's okay. He's gonna go nuts in that cast, though.
Yeah. I guess it puts a damper on the whole wilderness guide thing.
It's not a thing. It's a job. A career.
All right. Relax.
Len enters.
Excuse me, where's Elise?
Again?
Yeah, like you should talk.
It's down the hall to your right.
Rachel exits.
Excuse me. I noticed your name on the card. You wouldn't happen to know a Chad Armstrong, would you?
Yeah. How do you know Chad?
Well, he's my brother. He called out of the blue a few months ago and gave me your number. Thought we had a lot in common. We might hit it off.
Oh, right. Glenn, the day trader.
Former. I went bust.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. I should have called.
You're seeing someone.
I'm becoming a woman.
Have you thought about telling Chad?
He doesn't ask. I don't tell.
Evidently. Oh, evidently.
He told me about your apartment, though. $1,250 for a studio at 79th and Columbus? That's obscene.
You know my rent?
Lane, everybody knows your rent.
They do.
Oh, sure. I know the whole story. Your grandmother's dying words were, don't give up the lease. So you pay $1,250 and you can't move.
But you have to.
What?
Move.
No, I just did. To Jersey. I couldn't afford Manhattan anymore. But I'm dying to get back, so let me know if you're ever ready.
To what?
Move on?
Yeah. Nice to meet you, Glenn. Duh?
No, not Glenda. I'm going to be Glenda, like the Good Witch of the North.
Really? They call me the Wicked Witch of the East. Maybe we should meet for coffee and compare notes.
Oh, yes, let's. But don't forget, keep me on the list.
Len exits as Rachel enters.
What's the matter?
Do you think I should become a man?
Why would you want to become a man?
Because, oh, I don't know.
Oh, wait, this is a really bad day to play the I don't know game.
Because I'm all head.
You're all what?
I'm all head. I lost my body. I left it in a cab.
What?
3 years ago, on the way to Adam Feldman's, remember? Brain, so why not just become a man? Give me one good reason.
Maybe it's time to get out of New York. Minnesota's nice in the summer.
You always say that. I like New York. I like my job. I just want my body back.
So here, take mine. I have no head. I'm all Mary. I'm turning into one of those genetically altered turkeys.
What?
You know, the ones with all the white meat they sell around Thanksgiving. Nothing but breast. Look, can we get out of here, please? I've got to lie down.
Yeah. Let's go. I'm sorry.
Lane breaks down in tears. Rachel holds her. Michael enters and joins his sisters. The lights fade to black. Scene 2. A crisp October morning, 4 months later. I'm sorry, an evening 4 months later. The rooftop patio of a penthouse apartment in Manhattan. Sounds of a party can be heard inside. As the lights come up, Lane stands at a balcony looking out. Peter enters with a drink in hand and stands at the balcony, a distance from Lane.
View's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
I love being up this high. Makes my head spin.
Lane starts to go back into the party.
I think I see my old dorm up at Columbia.
Really?
Yeah.
My brother went there too.
Undergrad?
No grad, business school.
Oh, me too. What's his name?
Michael Gerson.
Oh, sure, Gers. He's a great guy. We used to play tennis together. Long time ago. Must be 8 or 9 years now. I kicked his ass last time we played. He probably still wants a rematch.
Yeah, knowing him.
I remember. He told me all about his sisters. You must be the older one. I met the other one once after we played.
I'm not much older, just a year.
Oh, your sister's a lot younger, right?
She's 30 now.
What was her name?
Rachel.
Yeah, she had just graduated from Brown, right? She was about to start med school.
Good memory.
She was really cute. What's she doing now?
Fellowship at the Mayo Clinic.
In Minnesota?
Yeah.
Jesus, you couldn't pay me enough money to live there.
I know, believe me.
So what's her specialty?
Oncology.
Oh, something light.
Yeah, well, she's sort of on a personal crusade. Both of my parents died of cancer. I'm sorry. That's pretty heavy.
It's okay. Not like I'm a total stranger. I'm really sorry to hear about your parents. Was it recent? I don't remember Michael mentioning anything.
It was after you knew him. My mother a couple of years ago and my father just a couple of months.
Ah, I can see why your sister's on a mission.
Well, it's actually on hold. She just had twins.
Oh, congrats. So she's...
Married. Yes. You're out of luck.
Hey, I was just asking. So, what about Michael? What's he up to?
I don't know. It's a mystery to all of us.
Why? He joined a cult or something?
He works in Silicon Valley. He's VP of sales and marketing at a high-tech company. They make signals.
Like smoke signals?
Yeah. It's their wireless strategy.
Nice. So, what do you do?
I'm a lawyer.
Oh. So you must know the people the party's for. I came with a friend of mine. I don't know anyone.
Yeah, I know them.
My friend told me they did a great job. That police brutality cases aren't easy to win, especially in civil court.
They're not.
I haven't read much about it.
Oh, no?
Well, I just moved back to the city last week. I was working over in Tokyo for a couple of years.
Doing what?
Investment banking.
Oh, welcome home.
Arigato.
Yeah, I know it means thank you. My roommate at Yale, she was Japanese.
So, tell me something.
What?
Why are police brutality cases so hard to win?
Oh, I don't know exactly.
Really? I figured you would as a lawyer.
It's not my area. Oh, look. Everyone's starting to dance.
Hey, did you hear about that one prosecutor? She got a lot of attention from the press. Apparently, she really nailed one of the defendants. I don't know her name. Do you know who I'm talking about?
Yeah.
She must have some balls to take on the NYPD. I hear they've been calling her the Wicked Bitch of the East. That's pretty funny, don't you think?
Hilarious. You know, I hear she's not so tough. But she's actually very sweet.
No.
Yes!
I don't know. She's got to be pretty cutthroat. One of those tough cookies, you know?
No. I mean, she may be a cookie, but I hear she's not that tough.
Yeah, right.
Peter takes a swig of his drink and crunches on the ice.
Wanna know what kind of cookie she is?
Yeah, sure. What kind?
How about peanut butter? Doesn't that sound good right now?
Natsu ni arerugenato.
Meaning?
I'm allergic to nuts. So, this sweet cookie, she wouldn't happen to be single, would she?
Yeah, I think so.
Really? That's surprising. Though I guess she probably doesn't have much time for a social life with work and everything.
That may not be the case, but I don't know. You'd have to ask her yourself.
Oh, good idea. Well, why'd you introduce me? Let's go back to the party.
Oh, you want to meet her now?
Sure, why not? Maybe she wants to dance. You like to play pretend, don't you?
I thought I had you.
You may be a great lawyer. lawyer, but you're a terrible liar.
I wasn't lying. I was withholding the truth. There's a difference.
Don't try to win on a technicality.
When did you figure it out?
You looked like you were going to heave when I said you had balls.
I'm a little sensitive to that particular metaphor.
Well, you could have just told me who you are.
But then I wouldn't have had the pleasure of hearing you call me a cutthroat.
Hey, I was teasing. I meant it as a compliment.
Yeah, right.
Look, I'll make it up to you over lunch. My treat. Is that acceptable? Come on, I just moved back. I need a new Gerson to play with.
You do?
I do, do you?
I do.
So, lunch?
No.
No, what do you mean, no?
I mean dinner.
What?
There's a new place around the corner for me. Want to go? Tomorrow night?
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Good. Here's my card. Give me a call and we can make a plan.
Lane fishes out a card from her purse.
So, what's my new playmate's name?
Peter Goodwin, and you are?
She hands him the card.
Elena B. Gerson.
Oh, you can call me Lane.
Okay, Lane it is. That's your real name or just the one you use for sting operations?
Look, I've never worked on such a high profile case and I didn't want to talk about it anymore. That's all, I don't usually play pretend. I don't.
I'll call you.
As Peter exits, a distinctly more feminine looking Glenn enters carrying a tray of appetizers. Peter takes one and exits. Lane waves him off. As Glenn exits, Michael enters and takes a piece of shrimp from the tray. He comes up behind Lane and puts his hand over her eyes.
Back so soon?
What?
Michael?
He removes his hands.
Who do you think it was?
Did you see?
Who?
Never mind. What are you doing in New York?
I had a sales pitch. Last minute thing. I'm just in for the day.
Why didn't you call me?
I did. Earlier. You worked in your office. I tried your cell, you didn't answer. Where were you?
I was in the middle of a sting operation.
Really?
Couldn't talk.
Is that right? Did you get the eye?
Too early to tell, but it looks promising. We've got another encounter tomorrow night.
And wired?
Wired? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure I'll be a wreck. Hey, how'd you call my cell? I just got a new number yesterday. What are you, a psychic hotline?
Yeah, I'm the Yuri Geller of Touchtone.
Nice. Point for Michael.
Yeah, your assistant gave me the number. She told me about the party, too. She thought you'd be happy to see your brother.
Michael gently punches Lane in the gut.
Stop it. How's Rachel? Did you talk to her today?
Yeah, the little guys are just screaming their heads off. I told her to get the remote, press mute. She didn't find that funny. I think she's freaking.
Yeah, the Queen of Serene has finally met her match. I feel so bad I didn't get out there.
What were you going to do? You were in the middle of a huge case.
Yeah, I know, but... So what's up with you? Did you decide about Patricia?
Yeah. I think it's a go.
You think? You're still not sure.
Oh, no. I was waiting for things to settle down at work. I'm going to do it. Tomorrow night.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Congrats.
Yeah. Look, I picked up the ring today.
Michael takes out an enormous diamond ring.
Oh my god.
Try it on.
Michael.
Come on, I want to see.
Lane puts on the ring. Michael lifts her hand and they look at the ring together.
It was a hell of a win, you know. Dad would be proud.
You think?
Yeah. Yeah. Proud of his girl. Really had balls. What?
Lane takes off the ring.
Nothing.
What?
Here. It's beautiful.
Yeah. Hey, look, I'm late. I gotta get to the airport.
Wait!
What?
Do you remember a guy from Columbia named Peter Goldman?
Peter Goodman?
Goodman?
Yes, yeah.
Goodman.
Yeah! Yeah, great tennis player. He kicked my ass the last time we played. If you see him, tell him I want a rematch when I'm in town.
You're coming back to New York?
Yeah, in like 2 weeks.
Were you going to tell me?
Yeah, of course.
What are you coming out for?
Conference.
Does it have a name?
You don't want to know.
Of course I do.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do. You know how I love it when you talk tech. Come on, tell me.
All right. It's the International Symposium on Intelligent Signal Processing and Communication Systems.
Oh, sure. The ISISPCS.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, nice. 1 point for Lane.
Uh-oh. One apiece.
I gotta go.
So quick, think of a tiebreaker.
The first one with good news tomorrow night wins.
What?
If Patricia says yes before you nail your guy, I win. And if you nail your guy first before I propose, then you win. Bring yourself so I can call you.
Why are you so sure you're going to be calling me?
Because you're going to get stung.
What?
The sting operation. You're going to get stung? What? What?
It just wasn't funny. Not like Yuri Geller. Go!
Michael gives Lane a kiss on the cheek and looks at her. Blackout. Scene 3 of the following evening. Glenn sets up two restaurant tables. One table is in New York, the other is in San Francisco. Patricia and Lane enter and head toward different tables.
Would you care for a drink while you're waiting?
Chardonnay. Cabernet.
Right away.
Glenn exits. A pair of cell phones ring. Lane and Patricia take the phones out of their purses.
Mom, Rach, I can't talk now. I'm in the middle of a restaurant.
No, I'm not engaged yet.
Yes, I'm still a woman. Not funny.
He's running a little late.
I'm waiting for a date.
Yes, he's gonna ask tonight.
No, he's a nice guy.
I mean,
I think he is.
Mother, please.
Call me tomorrow.
I'll call you later.
Bye.
Patricia and Lane end the calls and snatch the phones back in their purses. Len returns with drinks as Michael and Peter enter.
Here's your wine. Oh, and your company. Would you care for a drink?
Stoli.
On the rocks.
Make it a double.
Make it.
Double?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Len exits.
Hi, baby.
Michael gives Patricia a kiss on the lips and sits.
Hi, Peter.
Hey, Lane.
Peter gives Lane a kiss on the cheek and sits.
Hi, honey.
Sorry, I'm late.
Subway was stolen, 14th.
101 was murder Friday night. Or just, it's just the worst.
It's okay. I haven't been here long. How was your day?
Insane.
Good.
Good, but insane.
Michael takes a sip of water and gestures yours to Patricia.
How was yours?
Mine? Close is fine. Single. Good wine.
Glenn returns with drinks.
Are you ready to order, or do you need a few more minutes?
Need a few.
Need a few?
Yeah, we do.
Take your time. Specials are on the board across the room.
The diners crane their necks and squint their eyes.
Don't worry about it. We're out of everything anyway.
Glenn exits. The diners open their menus.
Why was your day so crazy?
Because patty cake. Marie was feeding. We finally got ourselves the VP of sales. Kurt Jones accepted the job.
Oh, Michael, that's awesome. I'm so happy for you.
Fish looks good. What are you going to have?
I don't know yet. So this means you won't have to do two jobs, right? Just marketing, not sales too. So things should ease up.
Ease up? English, please. I don't recognize that phrase.
Well, you won't have to work such long hours, right?
I wish. We're going to try to buy Signalocity in the next few months, so things are really going to heat up.
Oh. It all looks so good. Do you know what you want?
No, not yet.
I thought you said after you got this position filled, you'd be able to relax a little bit.
Yeah.
Work less.
Yeah, we're going to be a little bit more relaxed, but it's going to be the same old hours. $8 million sales lady, you're no slacker either.
Yes, but when we talked about it.
Yeah, what?
Nothing. It all looks so yummy. Do you know what you want?
No, not yet.
Grilled swordfish it is.
That's what I was thinking.
Nice place. Good call, Ling.
I'm glad you could make it tonight.
Yeah, thanks for the invite. Hey, too bad I missed Michael last night.
He'll be back in a few weeks.
Is he staying with you?
When you're under my bed?
Oh, come on. Your place can't be that small. Don't tell me they don't pay well at the U.S. Attorney's Office.
Oh, they pay us okay. But I have such a ridiculous deal on my studio, I'm not allowed to move.
Not allowed? Says who?
Grandma Rose.
Is she...
alive? No. But those were her dying words to me.
No.
Yes. She was lying in her hospital bed, barely conscious. She had had heart attacks, congestive heart failure, you name it. She was 91 and it was just time. So my family was going in one by one to say goodbye. When it was my turn, I went in and took her hand, and all of a sudden her eyes popped wide open and she says in this frantic voice, "Felice, Felice, don't give up, Felice." So I said, "Grandma, don't worry, I won't, I promise." She closes her eyes again and lets out this huge sigh of relief. And that was it.
No.
Yes. The worst part about it was that Michael was the only one who hadn't had a chance to say goodbye yet. And he was crazy, I mean crazy about Rose. That's why he hates
As opposed to the heart disease.
I'm not saying it's rational.
Well, you're right. You're not moving anywhere. But if you ever change your mind...
Yeah, don't worry. I'll put you on the list. You'll have to come up and see it sometime. It's actually very sweet.
Just like the lady of the house.
They raise their glasses.
So, what do you pay?
Peter!
Well, come on. It's New York. What do you pay?
$1,250.
Wait. You pay $1,250 for a studio at 79th and Columbus?
Oh my god, that's obscene.
It's incredible! I got released from my grandmother!
Can you believe that? I ended up in Jersey. I couldn't even look in Manhattan.
Lane looks intently at Glenn, slowly recognizing him.
Oh my god.
Yeah, well, I just moved back to the city. I'm paying more than four times that for a closet.
We'll have a swordfish grill. Salad? Appetizer?
No.
Me neither. Thank you.
Lane takes the menu from Peter and hands them to Glenn.
Where's the ladies' room?
Down the hall to your left.
Lane exits. Glenn walks over to the other table.
Sorry to keep you folks waiting. What would you like?
I'll have the air-crusted oil tuna. Rare, please.
Why don't you just save the tuna?
It's an excellent choice. One of my favorites.
Oh, come on.
Michael?
Oh, you're right. I've never had it before. So how would you like the swordfish, girl?
Yeah. How'd you know I wanted the swordfish?
Lucky guess.
That's pretty funny, don't you think? He's like the Uri Geller of food service. He's the guy who used to bend spoons.
It's
just by thinking about it.
It's pretty obscure.
Lane got it.
Lane's his sister. She gets everything. She's in her brain. What? What? That's what you told me. You used to call her Lane the Brain.
How about a bottle of wine with your meal?
Yes, Michael, let's order champagne. What do you say?
Is it a special occasion?
Michael?
Is it a special occasion? Is it?
Yes.
Sir?
Yes! Yes! New hire.
What?
New hire. Kurt Jones is coming on board.
Well, that certainly calls for some bubbly. Our list is right there. I'll come back in a bit and see what you'd like to order.
Excuse me, where's your ladies' room?
Down the hall, you're right.
Patricia exits as Lane enters. As Patricia passes by Peter, he checks her out. Lane catches this.
She's cute, huh?
What?
I'm just teasing. I brought you in the cookie jar, that's all.
What are you talking about?
Peter, nothing. It's no big deal. You just checked out that woman and, I don't know, it's weird to catch your date doing that. Not that I think you only have eyes for me sort of thing. I just caught you, that's all.
Yeah, you're very good at that.
I'm sorry, let's just drop it. So how's life in New York going? Is it weird to be back?
No, not really. Look.
Where?
No, look. I have to tell you something.
Oh.
I like you, Lane, but I don't want to give you the impression that this is a date.
Oh. Oh, you're right. Why would I think it's a date? We just, enjoy each other's company. We just have the same background. We just ordered the same fish.
Lane, I don't want to mislead you.
Then why did you accept my invitation? Don't you think you're sending mixed signals?
No, I just got back to the city. I'd like to meet new people. Those are the only signals I've sent.
So what's the problem? Why not consider this a date? You're not seeing anyone. I'm not seeing anyone. It feels like there's some chemistry. Why wouldn't you want to check this out and see what happens? What's the big deal?
Patricia enters and sits back at her table.
Look, I think you're really special, Lane. I do. But I just can't see the romantic part. I just don't feel it. Not that you're not attractive, you are. Everybody just has their type. I don't know. I can't explain it.
You can't explain it or you won't.
What difference does it make?
You can't or you won't.
Lane.
Answer the question.
Stop grilling me. I'm not a fucking witness.
Patricia, I adore you. I do. But there's just something to...
I'm just trying to understand.
There's just something to...
What? Say it!
Different.
Similar.
I mean,
You're practically like my sister. I
can't explain.
It's just a gut feeling. I don't know. It's like I'm looking in the mirror.
I'm not sure if we have enough in common. I
want to keep seeing you, Lane. I like you. I do. But
I
can't we just, you know, hang out?
Oh God, I'm just trying to do the right thing. Patricia, please. Say something.
Game over.
Patricia gathers some things.
Maybe I should go. I didn't think you'd be this upset. Here, let me pick up the check. Lane.
Don't.
All right. Take care.
Peter leans over and gives Lane a kiss on the cheek. Patricia exits. Peter follows her out as Glenn enters and surveys the scene.
Did you want to order that champagne, sir?
What? No. No, never mind.
Your meals?
Homeless.
Ready for the check, then? I'll be right back.
Glenn exits. The lights fade to black. Scene 4. The following morning. Lights out in Lane's studio apartment. Lane is asleep in the little black dress she wore the night before. The intercom buzzes. Lane gets out of bed to answer it. Just as Lane nears the intercom, her cell phone rings. She trudges back toward the bed, finds the phone and hits speaker. Lights up on Rachel. She sits at a table attached to a breast pump and reads the New York Times.
Lane.
The intercom buzzes again, loud and long.
Hang on.
Lane.
Hang on.
She hits the intercom.
What do you want?
Movers.
Movers? It's 8:00 a.m.
That's when you wanted me to come.
Yeah, but I didn't think you'd show up.
She buzzes it up.
What are you doing? Can I wake you up?
Yeah, I was having a hot dream about a punctual moving man.
Moving man? Are you serious? It doesn't sound like your type.
I'm kidding. The movers just rang my buzzer and woke me up.
Movers? How could you? Rose will have a heart attack.
Rachel, she already did. I'm just moving Dad's old file cabinet to my office. I need all the room I can get in this place.
So how'd it go last night?
The doorbell rings.
Hold on.
Lane goes to the door and opens it. Tom enters with a dolly cart.
What happened?
I got dumped.
Why?
He said he couldn't explain it. I just wasn't his type.
Tom checks out Lane. Lane catches him. She points to the filing cabinet. Tom moves toward it with the dolly.
What's his type?
Oh, I don't know. I'm sure someone like the ETL would do it for him. Though I assume she's now an engaged woman and therefore off the market.
No, she's single.
No, no, Michael was going to propose. Oh my God, no wonder he didn't call. What happened?
Tom tries to lift the filing cabinet, but can't. He opens the drawer.
Excuse me, ma'am, I need this empty.
What?
I can't lift this, it's too heavy.
Well, I thought that's your specialty, lifting heavy shit.
Well, now, it wouldn't be my specialty for long if I throw my back out.
Will you call me back later?
No, hold on. So what do you want me to do?
Empty the drawers.
Into what?
Into whatever you like, ma'am, they're your files.
Fine, I'll get a couple of bags.
Lane gets on her knees, reaches under the bed, and takes out the world's largest shopping bag, a Macy's monstrosity.
Here, take.
The bag breaks, and a slew of other bags come tumbling out.
What's going on?
Like the shop.
I'll call you back.
Lane slams off the phone, lights off on Rachel.
Rough night.
Yes.
Why don't you just sit down on your,
Tom looks around for a chair.
Bed and breathe. I'll bag the files and take them down, and I'll come back for the cabinet, all right?
Lane sits on her bed. Tom starts bagging the files and stacking them on the dolly.
Would you like to call your friend back and find out why Michael didn't propose to PTL?
I don't need to. I know why.
You do?
Yes.
Why?
Because he thinks he wants someone like PTL. But deep down inside, he wants someone like EBG. But he never dates EBG. He only dates PTLs, but they're not EBG, so eventually he breaks up with them.
Well, if he really wants someone like EBG, why doesn't he just date her?
Because that's a Class E felony, at least in New York.
Why? Is she a child?
No! Not no. He just can't date EBG specifically, but he could date someone like her.
Well, why doesn't?
That's what I've been trying to find out during the game.
What game?
The Sand Game. We play it every summer down at the beach house. 5 years that you have.
What's the difference between a PTL and an EBG?
The former is very nice and very pretty, though, between you and me, not the brightest bulb in the chandelier, you know what I mean? The latter, on the other hand, is a brain, but not quite a babe.
According to who?
Lane gets up to put the extra bags back under the bed.
Well, is she nice, too, like PTL?
Yes. Well, most of the time.
But then it sounds like it's just a matter of degree.
And degrees. And that was my sister.
PTL is your sister?
Oh, God, no. On the phone, that wasn't my friend, that was my sister. PTL is Michael's girlfriend, or was. He was going to propose last night.
I see.
She should have seen it coming. He's done this at least 4 times before.
Done what?
The serious date and dump.
What?
As opposed to the casual date and dump. That's my specialty. What's yours?
Oh, you know my specialty.
How could I possibly know your specialty?
You told me. I lift heavy sheds.
Tom pushes the dolly out the door. Lane calls Rachel.
Rachel.
Lights up on Rachel.
Are you all right? What happened? Is the moving guy still there?
No, he went down to the truck. He'll be back in a few minutes. So what happened with Michael?
He called me last night. He sounded so upset that he couldn't do it, that he just knew it wasn't right.
Like with Jesse.
And Anna.
And Sandra.
Who?
Sandra Yang. S.Y. Shy is Rad.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about her. He said he was just going to get in his car and drive up the coast. Hope he's okay.
How did Patricia take it?
He's not really sure. Apparently she just got up and left the restaurant.
She didn't say anything?
All she said was game over.
The intercom buzzes.
Hello!
It's Tom.
Come on up. I guess I can introduce her to Peter after all.
Who? Patricia? That's a bad idea, don't you think?
Rachel, I'm kidding. You keep forgetting to take your irony supplement.
Offstage, we hear the twins start to fuss.
Look, I gotta go.
Why doesn't...
The twins are starting to cry.
No, why doesn't...
Because he's our brother!
I don't mean literally.
I know what you mean.
Then why can't he marry women who aren't us?
Because he's pulled in opposite directions. You don't have to be an Einstein to get this.
But what's pulling him? What? He's got to be able to name it, say it, something.
And if he can't?
The twins cry even louder. Rachel cries out to Eric.
Honey! Lane, he can barely answer how are you half the time. And you think that by lying in the sand and playing a game of charades, you're going to extract some kind of deep, dark confession out of him? That one summer, bewitched by those magical first rays of light, our brother Michael, who, God only knows, was no psych major, will recite with the acumen of no less than Freud himself the top 10 reasons why he can't fall in love with women who remind him of his sisters? Are you nuts? I gotta go my ass. You don't have to get out of the sand because you have to pee. You get up when Michael is done telling you about his latest girlfriend, when the Inquisition is over, right?
When did you figure it out?
What do you think, I'm still 5? He's stuck, that's all. He wants the familiar for friendship and banter and the unfamiliar for romance and sex. And he wants it all bundled into the same woman.
But that's impossible. You can't be familiar and unfamiliar at the same time.
Exactly. And that's why God invented Victoria's Secret. And that's why, dear sis, Michael's head will always be at war with his groin. So there you have it. Case closed. Move on.
The twins are howling.
No, I can't. Not yet. If I knew why, then...
Then what? Then what?
Rachel disconnects herself from the pub.
Oh, for God's sakes, Lane, leave him alone, or at least stop faking it. That's not the way Daddy's little girl was taught to compete, was it?
Rachel!
No, I've had it. I'm not going to ref over a bunch of bullshit anymore. Either play the sand game with Michael, or don't play at all. Don't just lie there and pretend. Patricia never did that.
She knocks over the bottles of newly pumped milk.
God damn it! God damn it! Eric! It's all a little ironic, Lane, isn't it? All of a sudden, you want to know what I think? Well, I think you should have gotten your ass out of here last month!
I couldn't get away, you know that. Eric was there and his mom too, right?
Yeah, but they're Lindstroms and they're so big and Swedish. I didn't curse it, I was scared.
But you're a doctor.
Exactly! I knew every detail of every complication that could possibly occur.
But nothing did.
I'm not saying that it's rational!
these cries recede. There is a knock at the door. Lane answers it. Tom enters.
Salsa.
What?
Salsa. That's my specialty.
Like with chips?
Would you like to go out salsa dancing?
I don't know how.
You can learn. I'll show you.
It's so nice of you to ask, really, but I can't. I'm totally swamped at work. I have to...
refile.
Exactly. I have a big new case coming up.
I see. Well, I better move that cabinet.
He loads the file cabinet onto the dolly.
I read about your last one, you know. That was quite a victory.
You read about it?
Yes.
Where?
In the paper.
In the Times?
Yes.
In the New York Times?
Yes.
Oh.
Sign here, please.
Tom gives Lane a receipt to sign. Lane signs it and returns it to Tom. He rips off a copy and hands it to her.
Here's your receipt and a card if you need any other heavy shit lifted.
She starts to leave.
Wait! Let me give you something.
No, you don't. All right. Thank you.
Tom takes a $10 bill from Lane. Her cell phone rings. Tom exits. Lane answers the phone.
Hi, Michael. No, I didn't mail him. Yeah, I know. Rachel just told me. Yeah. Yeah, still want a piece.
Blackout. The end of Act 1. There will now be a 10-minute intermission. Act 2, Scene 1. 3 weeks later, a weekday afternoon, Michael and Lane sit at a cafe table in New York. Lane reads her menu, Michael reads an article.
Huh?
What?
Nothing.
What?
Nothing. It's physics. You'd be interested.
You don't know that. What is it?
It's a journal article. Some scientist at the conference gave me a copy.
What's it about?
Dark energy.
Dark energy? That's a bit of an oxymoron, yes?
Yeah, exactly. It's repulsive gravity.
Repulsive gravity. What is that?
It's when things normally attracted to each other by gravity are instead repulsed.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Apparently Einstein first proposed it, but then he thought it was so bizarre he took it back.
But it really exists?
Yeah, they confirmed it. I don't know, about 10 years ago, maybe more.
How much of this dark energy is floating around the universe?
When did you get so interested in astrophysics?
Just tell me what it says. How much is there?
A lot. Looks like there's now more repulsive gravity than regular gravity.
Oh. Is it reversible?
What do you mean?
Does repulsive gravity ever turn back into regular gravity?
I don't think it can. I think they're two different types of forces.
So what if something's caught between them? If both repulsive gravity and regular gravity exert influence on something, what happens?
It doesn't say. It probably wouldn't move. Just stay where it is. Sort of like a New Yorker in a rent-controlled apartment.
Glenn, now Glinda, enters.
Hello, I'm Glinda, your server. Are you two ready?
Glinda, like from The Wizard of Oz?
Yes! And who would you be? Scarecrow, Tin Man, or the Cowardly Lion?
What, are you kidding? I'm the Great Oz, of course.
Oh my god.
Hey, that's pretty funny, don't you think? She's the Good Witch of the North, and you're the Wicked Bitch of the...
I'll have a coffee, black, and a lemon bar. You'll have a latte and a piece of cheesecake.
Lane grabs Michael's menu and hands them to Glinda.
Thank you. Thank you.
Glinda takes the menus and exits.
What? What's that about? She's cute.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, then go for it, Brother Michael. Change may do you good.
What does that mean?
Nothing. So how's the conference?
Yeah, you know. I'll play with your company if you play with mine, the usual bullshit. It's good to take a break.
And how's Patricia?
I don't want to talk about it.
Have you spoken to her since you broke up?
I said I don't want to talk about
it. Just one little question. Have you spoken to her?
Yeah. Once.
Is she okay?
I don't know. She didn't say much.
Are you going to try to work it out? I mean, you've dated her for more than 2 years.
I don't think so. I think it was the right decision.
Okay.
It's hard, you know. I miss her.
So then why did you end it?
Because I had to. It wouldn't have worked out in the long run. It wasn't right to spur her along.
So then what were you doing for 2 years?
I was dating someone. What have you been doing?
Linda enters.
Look, sometimes you can't explain these things, just a gut feeling. I know you didn't like her. I thought you'd be relieved to hear that we broke up.
That's not the case, not at all.
Linda lays down the coffee and pastries on the table.
Looks great. Thanks.
You're very welcome. I slept all night in the kitchen baking.
Oh, come on.
Oh, you're right. I'm no Pillsbury Doughboy. Let me know if you need anything else.
Should we...
Don't say it.
Click our heels?
He said it. Just for that, he gets the check.
Linda puts down the bill and exits.
What?
Linda Armstrong. G.A. God Almighty. It could work!
How do you know her last name?
Her brother Chad wanted to set me up with her.
What?
Long story.
What are you trying to tell me?
Nothing.
No, come on, Lane.
All right, all right. I'm trying to tell you that my love life is so bad these days that I'm getting fixed up with transsexual weight persons.
She's a he?
Yes, she's a he, or was, or will be, I don't know. When we met, she was still Glenn, the good warlock of the North. He was a day trader, if you can believe it. He went bust.
Boy, did he ever. He's very attractive. I mean, cheap.
I agree. I should have such legs.
God, that's amazing. But her brother wanted to fix you up. What was he thinking?
He didn't know.
You didn't know?
No. Apparently they have a strict don't ask, don't tell policy.
Things aren't going very well for you, socially?
No, Michael, they're not.
Is that why you want to become a man?
What?
Rachel called me.
She did.
Look, if you really want to, it's okay with that.
No, of course not. She knew I was kidding. I'm gonna kill her.
Relax. She's worried about you. She's just trying to help.
Yeah, well, so is Chad.
Hey, what about Peter? Peter Goodman. You asked about him a few weeks ago. He's a nice guy. Weren't you interested in him?
I was. He wasn't interested in me.
Not interested in you? Why not? What's his problem?
He said sometimes you can't explain these things. Just a gut feeling.
Lane, it's just that you're
Don't say that word. I'll vomit right here.
But
such a cliche. It's such a cliche. Special, applicable to half the women marching down the streets of Manhattan. All those big brains you think you recognize from your physics honors class or your eating club at Princeton or whatever, you call them special, Michael, but it's not like you'd ever want to fuck them.
Lane.
What? It's true, isn't it? It's not like you'd sleep with me if I weren't your sister, right? Right?
Linda enters the coffee.
Would you sleep with me? If I weren't your sister, would you want to have sex with me?
Linda turns to Mike.
Please, answer the question.
No! For God's sakes, you're my sister. That's disgusting.
It's hypothetical, not literal. Answer it!
No, it's sick. How could you ask me that?
Because I can't win, Michael. Because the Peter Goodmans of this world seem to find me totally undesirable. Sexually, romantically, whatever. But I'm a great friend. I'm their bosom buddy. I'm their special sister.
So what does that have to do with me?
Because all your girlfriends, they're never like me. Or even like Rachel. So on the surface, it seems like you pretty much ruled out the idea that anyone like your nice, smart Jewish sisters could be your girlfriend. Which I couldn't accept. If you could actually commit to one of them. But you can't. You can't. Which always gives me hope that one day you'll want someone like me. One day the Michael Gersons of this world will want someone like me. Because that's what I want. That's who I want. So I need to know. I need to know once and for all whether I should have hope. Whether you would ever want, and I mean really want, someone like me.
I can't.
You can't what?
I can't answer that, and you can't make me.
Let me rephrase the question. She is also your intellectual equal. She is one of those women you might call special. She is one of those women you might not call patty cake. Is such a scenario possible? Could Michael Alexander Gerson fall in love with such a woman?
If I answer that question, ties broken. I get the win, and you can't ask me anything else. Those are the rules.
Fine, fine. Could you? Could you fall in love with such a woman?
I did.
What?
I did.
When?
No. That's it. I win. I gotta get back to the conference.
Michael pulls out his wallet and takes out some cash.
How come you never told me?
God damn it. I need change. Where'd she go?
You told me about all your other girlfriends during the game. Why not this one?
Leave me alone. I answered your question.
No, you didn't. I asked a hypothetical, could you, not a confessional, did you? You didn't answer my question. You answered something else.
Don't try to win on a technicality.
You broke your own rule. Why is that, Michael? Why? You got something on your mind? You got something you want to say to me? Then say it.
Stop it.
No, the game's not over yet. It's still one apiece, so say it. Say it. Because if you walk out of here without full disclosure, then I win. Those are the rules now. What's the matter, Gers? Not up for it?
I didn't tell you because it didn't last very long.
When was it?
A couple of years ago. Right after Mom, you know.
Who was it?
Carolyn.
Carolyn who?
Carolyn Feldman.
Carolyn Feldman?
Yes.
My lab partner in chemistry?
Yes.
Where did you run into her?
She lives in San Francisco. She was working on one of our patents. She's an intellectual property lawyer.
So what happened?
It didn't work.
Why not?
It just didn't. Game over.
It just didn't is not exactly full disclosure.
I don't care. Enough already. Game over. Take the win.
Take it? Just take it.
Yes. Take the win and leave me alone.
Linda enters.
Aldo?
Yes.
No. More coffee, please.
Decaf, okay.
Linda pours Lane more coffee and picks up the check.
I'll be right back.
She exits.
What is it about the sand?
What?
How come you can talk about your girlfriends then?
You're the one who made that stupid rule. I have to.
Oh, come on, Michael. You're 38 years old. You don't have to do anything you don't want to do. There's got to be something different about this Am game.
Yeah, you. That's what's different. You're not so...
Not so what?
Not so intense. That's what I was going to say before. Not that you're so special. But you're so intense. You're not like that during the game. You just lie there and listen. You don't grill me like I'm some fucking witness.
So let's pretend.
What?
Let's pretend it's the sand game. Here. Come on. Sit back.
She leans back in her chair.
No.
Come on.
No, I told you. You won. Stop it already.
Michael, I'm all you got left. Everybody else is gone.
Rachel's...
No, Rachel's gotta go away too for a little while to mommy land. So I'm it. I'm it. You can go back to your conference and swap some more bullshit if you want. I'm not gonna stop you. But you had a feeling, Michael. A real feeling for someone. I haven't had that in so long I can't even imagine what it's like. So tell me about that feeling. Tell me. Tell me about Carolyn, please.
Michael leans back in his chair.
Good. Good. Now when I give the signal, start talking whenever you want. I won't say a word. Those are the rules. Okay? Ready? Spill.
Carolyn was great. She was great. She was really great. She got it. Totally got it. I didn't have to explain anything to her. My jokes, my work. It was just like, it was exactly when I talked to you. She just got it. She wasn't, you know, super gorgeous or anything, but she had a look. She glowed. It was incredible. I thought, this is it. She's the one. I thought that. I really did. And I didn't want to screw it up, so I just kind of avoided things, physically, you know. But we were talking almost every night, these deep, long conversations, you mixed signals, and she called me on it. She wasn't mad or anything. She was just calling a spade, like Rachel does, you know. I blamed it on work. Too busy for something serious. Plus, you know, with Mom and everything. But she wanted to move things along. I don't blame her. It's getting really intense. So she said, let's go away for a weekend. And I said, okay. I thought I was, you know, I thought I was ready. So we went up the coast. We went up the coast to this bed and breakfast. I remember it was freezing like, it was freezing outside. It was raining like hell. But as soon as we got inside this place, everything was warm. It felt like I was wrapped up and again in my blanket from camp. Remember that one? Mom threw it out. I was so pissed at her for that. I slept so good in that blanket. So we had this great dinner. Pot roast and gravy and mashed potatoes. You never see that on a menu out there. And it was just so good. It was just like being at Rose's for Sunday supper. That smell, taste. It's just how it was, except on top of it, I had this incredible face looking at me. And so I reached across the table. I grabbed her hands tight. I said, Carolyn, I love you. She lit up. You should have seen it. She lit up like a, I don't know, like a sunrise. Like a sunrise. She said it back. She said, I love you too. Her face was beaming. I'd never seen anything like that. It was so beautiful. So beautiful, that face. I'll never forget it. So after dinner, we go upstairs and we start, you know, we start fooling around. Things had been sort of pent up for a while, so we started, you know, heating up. Things were starting to heat up on it quickly, and she headed south. The next thing you know, I'm calling her these names like caramel and stuff. And I'd never done anything like that before with her. I don't know what made me start then. It was just like I don't know. It just. So she stops the action. She looks up at me and she says, would you say my name? Would you call me Carolyn? Spade is spade. Call me Carolyn. And then she starts, you know, again. And I tried. I did. I tried, but I couldn't. God, I felt like such a moron. It was just a word. It was just a stupid word. Why'd she make me do that? Why didn't she get it? It just... Christ, I don't know. It just felt good. So I said, come on, Verse. Come on. Just look at that face again. If you can see the face, you can say the name. If you can see the face, you can say the name. And then... I mean, it was just so dark in there, and I couldn't see it, so I reached out, and I pulled her back up, and I looked for it. For the face, but it was gone. It was gone. It wasn't glowing. It was beautiful, it was just sweaty and gross, and her skin and her breath. It reeked.
Of what? Say it.
Of you. Of Rachel. Of a thousand person woman. It was so.
What? Real? Intense?
Familiar! Oh! It reeked of the familiar. I couldn't.
What? You couldn't what?
Shut up.
Tell me.
I pushed her off.
You what?
I told her to go away.
Oh my God!
Leave me alone.
Were that repulsive?
I loved her, Lane.
But you didn't want her.
I loved her.
But you didn't want her, Michael. You didn't want Sister Carolyn. Say it.
Leave me alone.
Say it.
Leave me alone!
Michael lunges toward her, smacking the dishware off the table. It crashes to the floor. Glinda enters and surveys the scene. She approaches and picks up the dishes. She exits.
Don't wait, Lane. Do not wait for Peter Goodman to come knocking on your door. Believe me, he left the neighborhood years ago.
But that's what I want. I want the familiar.
But they don't want you, Lane. Don't you get it? Those days are over. There are too many other... How many other forces pulling them away? It's like repulsive lab gravity. It's all that's left.
Well, why?
They don't know. They just don't know the source. They don't know why it exists. All they can do is confirm that it does. So accept it. Accept it and move on.
But where?
I don't know. Don't look at me.
But
look somewhere.
I don't know.
Look somewhere else. I gotta go.
He gathers his things and starts to exit.
You know, Michael.
He stops.
When you pulled her back up, that wasn't just Carolyn, that wasn't just me, that wasn't just Mom. That was your smell, your taste, that was you.
Michael looks at her as Glinda enters.
Who gets the change?
She does.
Michael exits. Glinda puts down the change and turns to walk away. Lange is overcome and begins to cry. She reaches out and catches Glinda's arm. Glinda looks back at her. The lights fade to black. Scene 2. The following Saturday morning, the lights come up in Lane's apartment. Nearby Lane are the shopping bags with her files. Tom unloads the file cabinet off the dolly.
Just seems so empty, you know? The spot. I've been staring at it for like a week now, and I didn't know what to put there instead, and I really do work at home a lot, so makes sense to have it there.
Tom finishes putting the cabinet in place.
There you go. You're all ready to file again. Is there anything else you'd like me to do for you today, Ms. Gerson?
No. I think that's it.
You're not sure?
No. No. Yes. Yes. No. I'm sure.
All right, then. Sign here.
Lane signs the papers, and Tom gives her the receipt.
Oh, wait, let me get you something.
You really don't have... Thank you.
Tom starts to leave, but a CD case on the bed stops him. He picks it up.
I picked it up online. I'm trying to learn a little.
You can't learn by yourself.
You can't?
No, I'm sure.
Oh. Can you ask again? Please.
Would you like to go salsa dancing?
Yes.
Good. When?
Now.
Now?
Yes. Yes, now. Here.
Here?
Yes, here now. I mean, if it's okay, I don't want to get you in trouble with your boss.
I think I'll be all right. Why don't you put it in the CD and I'll teach you the basics.
It's in.
Lane picks up a remote and turns on the music. Tom takes his coat off.
Come here. Stand next to me.
She does.
Now you have to be able to hear the beat. If you can hear the beat, then you can salsa. Listen to the music. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Can you hear it?
No. Oh well, so much for...
Listen.
Tom claps with the music.
Wait. Wait. Yeah, I can hear it.
Good. Now on one, you put your left foot forward. On two, tap your right foot in place. On three, you bring your left foot back to its original position. And on four, stand still. Let me see you do that. Ah, that's it. Now move your right foot back on five. Tap your left foot in place on six. Then bring your right foot back to position on seven and hold on eight. You've got it. Now go forward and then back. That's the basic step.
That's it?
Yes, that's it. Let's do this for a bit until you feel comfortable.
Tom and Lane dance the basic salsa step side by side.
Do you have another move this morning?
No.
And you sure you won't get in trouble with your boss?
If I do, I'll just ground him.
What?
He's my son.
You work for your son?
Not exactly. He recently started this moving business. I'm visiting for a few weeks to lend him a hand. Now relax your hips a little.
She does her best.
That's better.
Tom and Lane continue practicing the basic step.
It's not easy to start a new business. How old is he?
My son? He's 22. He may be a little young for you, but I'm sure you'd be his type.
Oh, stop.
Here, face me, put your left hand on my shoulder, and your right hand against mine.
Like this?
Whoa, easy, and don't clench. Just place your palm flat against mine.
What do I do next?
You follow me.
What?
You start on your right foot, and after that, follow my lead. My job is to make sure my partner looks good.
They do the basic step.
That's it. All you have to do now is pick up my cues.
Cues? What?
He spins her.
Whoa!
Just follow my lead.
They continue to dance.
No offense, but you don't look like a salsa king. When did you take this up?
Long time ago, about 25 years.
Why?
Well, I just started out in the Civil Engineering Corps.
Is that the Army?
Navy. I was stationed in Guam. There was a salsa club near the base. I used to go there for some R&R.
So you're in the military?
And I'm recently retired.
And you're an engineer?
Yes.
Oh, so you don't usually lift shit?
No. I generally flush it.
And you've been doing salsa ever since Guam?
Well, I stopped for a long time. A few years ago, I started taking lessons again. It helped me through some tough times. Now here, step to the side. No. Opposite. With me.
She corrects her step.
Good.
Were you ever married?
Yes. I'm divorced.
I'm sorry. So, what do you do now?
I run a small waste management company.
Where?
San Diego.
California?
What's the matter?
Nothing. The weather, it's so sunny.
Tom puts out his hand. Lane again hesitates, but takes it. They resume dancing.
Don't look at my feet, look at me and smile.
It feels so unnatural.
Well, try at least to erase the worry lines.
Believe me, it's been a fortune trying to erase them. So, how often do you come to New York?
You've asked a lot of questions.
Sorry, that's my job.
Guess what?
What?
He gives her a spin and a dramatic dip.
You're not at work.
He lifts her up.
All right, you've got the basics.
Tom turns off the music.
Ready to move on?
But I don't know the steps.
You don't have to.
Look, I don't know. I'm not very good at this.
You don't have to be. You just have to enjoy it.
No, this is crazy. I mean, who salsas in their studio?
The same woman who doesn't really want her file cabinet back. I thought you wanted to learn something new. Try something different.
It was dumb.
What was dumb? Coming down from your Ivy League tower? Isn't that today's game?
It's not a game.
Then what is it? Why am I hauling a file cabinet around Manhattan?
I don't know!
What is it you want?
I don't know!
Lane, I remember when my son couldn't tell me what he wanted. It was the most frustrating thing in the world for him, for both of us. I was 25 at the time, he was 2.
Tom goes to get his coat.
What are you doing?
Leaving.
No!
You know?
No, I don't want you to.
Lady, it seems to me you don't know what you want.
That's not true.
Oh, no? Then what? Lane, what do you want? No more games!
Lane doesn't answer. Tom goes to the dolly and starts to wheel it out. After Tom passes by her, Lane reaches out and catches his arm.
I want...
What? Say it.
I want it to go away.
What?
The dark energy.
What?
I want it to go away. I don't want to repulse anyone anymore.
What's dark energy? Who have you repulsed?
All of them. Peter, David, Josh, you name it. Even Adam. Adam Feldman.
Who's that?
Ugh, he's this guy from high school. He was a year behind me. His sister Carolyn was in my class. She used to tease me about what a crush he had on me. He was kind of cute. Sort of dorky, you know? Anyway, about 3 years ago, I ran into him at some charity thing. He's some muckety-muck political consultant now. We seem to hit it off. So he asks me out, we go, we have a good time. He asks me out again. So, you know, after a couple of dates, he says, let's go back to his place. In the cab on the way over, he's holding my hand and telling me how happy he is that we found each other again. We go up to his apartment, talk for a while, have some wine. It was getting late, so he gives me a pair of his flannel pajamas to change into, which at the time I thought was sort of sweet. I go into the bedroom and change while he's in the bathroom. He comes out wearing flannel pajamas too. So there we were, 35 years old, looking like a couple of kids from the Land's End catalog. It was ridiculous. Anyway, we climb into bed and he turns out the light. And then he just rolls over and goes to sleep. I lean over to kiss him and he says, "No, Lane, no, it's nice, just like this, don't you think?" I'm obviously picking up a weird vibe at this point, so I say, "You know, Adam, maybe I should leave." And he says, "Why? I really want you to stay. I like you, Lane, I do. I think you're really special." A lot of women would have left. I know that. Rachel would have. Patricia definitely would have. But not Lane. I thought, he probably just had too much wine. He just needs a little more time. I thought, hang in there. Don't give up. So the next morning, I'm leaning over the sink, washing my face. He comes into the bathroom and puts his hand up my pajama top and starts, you know, stroking my back. He says, "Lane, your skin, it's so soft." I was so relieved. I was so happy. I thought, way to hang in there, Lane, way to go. But then all of a sudden, his hand jerks off my back like he's been shocked, and he pulls it out of my shirt. I say, "Adam, what's the matter?" And he says, "I don't know, something that just doesn't feel right. It feels like what?" I said, "Like what?" And he looks at me in the mirror and he says, "It feels like I'm touching my sister." And he walks away, repulsed by the familiar. That's what dark energy is, Tom, at least in my universe. And I thought I could beat it. I thought if I hung in there long enough, I could win, but I'm not gonna win that game. I can't win, and I don't wanna play anymore.
So what do you want?
I want gravity. I want good old-fashioned gravity. But it's been so long since I felt it. I don't know what to do. I don't know where to look. I don't know where it's gone.
Lane, look at me. That's all you have to do. Look at me.
He doesn't look.
Listen to me. It's a big universe out there. There's a lot of gravity still. A lot. You don't have to look for it. You just have to look at it. That's all. Look.
Lane hesitates a long moment, then steels herself and looks at Tom. He puts out his hand.
Look.
Lane and Tom slowly move toward one another.
Elena Garrison, would you care to dance?
Oh, yes. Yes, I would. I would love to dance.
Come here.
Don't we need music?
No. If you can hear the beat, you can salsa.
Tom and Lane dance a silent salsa. The moves get more complicated as the lights fade to black. Scene 3. The following summer, just before dawn, Rachel sits on the back deck of a beach house holding two faded plastic yellow mini shovels. Michael enters, carrying a duffel bag, sneaks up behind Rachel and covers her eyes.
"I thought you wanted to sleep in, big man."
Michael roots man.
"Oh, Michael."
Rachel gives Michael a hug.
"It's so good to see you. Why aren't you in your bathing suit? It's almost time."
"I just got in."
"What?
Did you see my flight was delayed?"
"Yeah, of course, but we were all so tired we just went to bed. We didn't think you'd get here till just before dawn. Why didn't you just stay in a hotel by the airport and come down today?"
"And miss the game? Come on. Where's Lane? She's here, right?"
"Yeah, I'm sure she'll be out in a minute."
"How's she doing? I haven't really talked to her in a long time."
"I know. She told me. You should have heard her last night. She was so funny. She was telling us about her new boyfriend."
"Seeing someone?"
"Yeah, since last fall."
"Since last fall? How come you didn't tell me?"
She just told me last night."
"If she's not going to tell you, how am I supposed to find out?"
"I guess you're going to have to ask her yourself."
Yeah. What's his name?"
"Tom. Tom Piper."
"Piper? Not Jewish?"
"Oh, yeah. Like you should talk."
"Shut up. Where do you go to school?"
"How should I know?"
"Where's he from?"
"San Diego."
"San Diego? You should be going all the way up there?"
"Yeah, about once a month or so."
"Oh, must be think she'd come up to see me. Who's this guy? What's he do?
He moves shit.
What?
That's what she said. He moves shit and he sauces.
What is he, a dancing enema?
She's happy. Go change.
Michael starts to exit.
Oh, Michael. She bought a place. She's moving out of the studio.
You're kidding. Rose will have a heart attack.
She already did.
Who got the lease?
I don't know. Some woman named Glinda.
God almighty. Only in the
Michael exits. Off stage, the babies start to cry. Rachel breathes deeply. The cries recede into a whimper and then silence. Lane enters carrying two blankets.
What are you doing up?
Oh, yeah. Like you don't know.
Go back to bed. We were up so late.
I'm fine.
Where's Michael?
He's coming. He's getting changed.
What time did he get in?
He just walked in the door. His flight was really delayed.
You're kidding. He must be exhausted.
I'm sure he'll make it through the game.
Yeah. Are the babies okay? I hear them crying.
They're fine. Sometimes they wake up early in the morning, but they usually go right back to sleep.
I went in and watched them last night for a bit. They look so peaceful, all wrapped up in their little blankets. I'm sorry you haven't been out to see them more.
It's okay. You were busy.
Yeah, really busy.
With the moving van.
Oh, stop!
Lane starts to go down to the beach.
Hey, Lane!
What?
What's with the blanket?
Shh! The babies!
Lane continues to the beach and wraps herself in one of the blankets. Michael enters.
What about the shovels?
I got him!
Michael grabs the shovels from Rachel and walks down to the beach.
How you been?
Fine. Fine. You?
Fine. Fine. So, which one do you want?
Michael offers Lane the shovels. She doesn't respond.
Come on. You know the routine. Take. Take.
No.
Take.
Michael.
Take.
No.
Michael looks up at Rachel for a call. Rachel motions for Michael to try again. Michael looks back at Lane.
Come on, I'm tired. Just take one.
Michael again offers Lane the shovels.
I don't want to play.
You don't want to what?
I don't want to play. And you can't play without me. Game over.
What?
Game over.
Rachel!
Hush, wake the baby.
Get down here.
Rachel runs down to the deck.
Be quiet.
No, you be quiet. You can't just decide by yourself. It's not just your game.
What's the matter?
She won't play.
What?
She wants to stop the game.
What do you mean she wants to stop the game?
Why are you asking me?
Why are you yelling at me?
Because you're the ref.
Jesus Christ. You don't want to play?
No.
Why not?
I just don't.
Why? You can win if you really try.
What do you mean if she really tried?
Either play the sand game or don't play at all. That's what you said. I choose the latter.
What do you mean? Play the sand game. What the hell game have you been playing?
A really stupid one, Michael. Let it go.
No, that's bullshit. You're telling me that since 1991 you've been faking it? You really have to go?
No, of course not. I let you win.
I didn't win, not if you weren't trying. God, Lane, Dad would be sick.
Oh, yeah? Well, so would Rose. You're still playing with shovels she gave you when you were six.
Okay, that's it. I'm making the call.
Yes, please do.
Do you agree?
Just make the call. You don't need his permission.
And you don't need to tell me how to ref. Remember, Rose? I'm not going through that again. You said your goodbye. Now it's his turn. Michael, are you ready? Are you ready to say goodbye to the sand game? What?
What am I?
What do you want? Say it.
When am I going to get to talk to Lane? Like I did during the sand game?
Is that it?
You can talk to me whenever you want. I will listen. I will. But I will not give you any more signals to start talking. You're going to have to do that on your own. Those are the rules. Okay? Okay?
Okay.
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 Okay. When you're ready, Michael, put the shovels down.
Michael deliberates and finally lays the shovels down. Rachel takes her sibling's hands.
Here we go. Sand game. Time of death, 5:33 a.m. What's the cause?
I don't care. Anything but cancer.
Or a heart attack.
How about
Eric lets out a long, loud, Tarzan-like yawn.
He appears to be up
and going back to bed.
Rachel gives her siblings a quick kiss each and runs toward the deck. Michael and Lane simmer in silence.
You should have told me. You shouldn't have played pretend.
You're right. I should have told you. I should never have played pretend. Here, it's freezing. Take.
Lane tosses in the other blanket.
Oh my God, it's my blanket! From camp! I thought Mom got rid of it.
No, she brought it down here. When you asked, she probably just forgot and figured she threw it out.
Michael wraps himself in the blanket.
Man, am I gonna sleep or what?
Michael sits down by Lane. Dawn breaks, and the light falls on them. Rachel looks at her siblings one last time before exiting.
So, tell me about the dancing and, tell me about Tom.
I will, in a bit. Thanks.
The lights continue to brighten.
I could never see it before, when we played the sand game.
What?
The sunrise. It's so beautiful. So beautiful. Don't you think?
Michael, pain, looks away. Lane reaches out and takes Michael's hand. Together, they watch the sun rise. The lights brighten until they finally